Dawn, welcome back. It feels like no time at all since we were last speaking.
That's right. Good to see you again, Mike.
So for those of you who don't know Dawn, haven't seen any of the videos I've done with her, Dawn is an innovative project management trainer. She has made it her mission to make complicated ideas from project management, like the PMP syllabus and the PMBOK in general, as accessible and easy to understand as possible, and as practical as she can make it as well. And to support that, she's coined the idea of project land, the world where projects happen, a world where the rules are just a little bit different. And if it's out by the time this video comes out, there'll be a link to her forthcoming book called Welcome to Project Land, or maybe called Welcome to Project Land, in the description below. So welcome back, Dawn.
Thank you, Mike. Thanks for having me again. It's always good to see you.
It's a pleasure to have you on. And what we're going to do today is something a bit different. We are going to be an agony auntie and uncle. We'll leave it to the listeners to figure out who's who. And we're going to answer one of my questions that have come from my community. I get asked a lot of questions, and I've put them onto a sheet. So let's just take a look to prove that that sheet exists. So I've got a sheet. I've also got just an ordinary six-sided die here. What we're going to do is pick one of the first six. You don't know what any of them are. I mean, I've typed them, so I do know what they are, but I've not done any preparation. Three dimensions. Right. Let's see which one we select to answer, and you'll get first go at giving some advice. So what number have we got there?
Oh, looks like we got a five.
We've got a five. There we go.
What is question number five, Mike?
Okay, question number five. Our listener says, I've never worked on a project with so many stakeholders. It's usually no more than five or six, they say, although probably they're missing a few, I suspect. But there are 60 or 70 individuals and about 20 organizations. So this is sounding like quite a big project. How can I keep track of them and what we've said to them? So this is someone who wants some advice on basically how to manage the relationships and track the relationships with a large number of stakeholders. Let's start off. Is that something you have experience of?
Yeah, definitely. I had a project that we called the $100 million bet, and it was a global project with a rollout all over the world and a Fortune 500 company. And we had loads and loads of stakeholders. Yeah, so I can totally feel the pain of anybody that has loads and loads of stakeholders. But even if you don't have loads of stakeholders, these tips are really important. So one of the things that I, you know, in your intro, you said I like to try to make it fun and accessible to learn this stuff. And so the tip that I shared in one of our other videos together about stakeholders, I'm going to repeat that a little bit here, if that's okay, Mike.
Yeah, please.
So I like now to think about stakeholders in three categories. And my clients have enjoyed this as well because it's easy to think about. So if you think about stakeholders as the people who might love your project, hate your project, or be somewhere in between, then you're dealing with only three categories.
Yeah.
Okay. And so what we have is a thinking tool that is called SAM. So in my classes, I'm like, meet Sam. Sam meets team, you know? And Sam is the stakeholder analysis and management matrix.
Okay.
And so you list all your stakeholders. We have this tiny little column with C, F, and S on it. And everybody's like, what is that? And I'm like, exactly, it's a secret column. Because you don't want people knowing that you've labeled them as a cheerleader, a finicky fan, or a saboteur. Yeah. So the cheerleaders are the people who love your project. They're so excited. They've wanted this for a long time. And the concern is that they could meddle.
Yeah.
Right? So you want to give them something constructive to do. Mm. So when you organize them in like an Excel spreadsheet, right? Like our SAM, then you sort them all out and you can say, okay, you know, these are the cheerleaders. What can we do with them as a whole? Mm. So you kind of lift it up and step back. And then you can do the same thing with the finicky fans, which flock together, right? So these are the people that are like, I'm not sure yet. I'm going to wait and see how this project is going before I decide to be a cheerleader or be a saboteur.
Yeah.
And so those people, you want to figure out, how can we push them to being a cheerleader, right? Yeah. Absolutely. And the saboteurs are people who actively or passively may try to kill your project. I've had that happen. Yep. You know, hurt your project in some way, just be general issues for you, right? Yep. Because they don't like you, they don't like your project, whatever it is, whatever the reasons are. And yeah. so stepping back and figuring out how are we going to limit their ability to sabotage this project? What do we do yeah. about it? Is really, really important. And you want to have this as a very private conversation with you, maybe, yeah. you know, one or two other key people, the sponsor and help. And it's not all on you
yeah.
to do all of the stakeholder management, right? So in the $100 million bet project, we had a few key people that had relationships and were well respected around the world.
Yeah.
Do stakeholder management for certain stakeholder groups.
Yeah.
That became part of their job on the project. So yeah. that's kind of what was on my mind first when you
that's great. And I like the kind of finicky fan characterization, because a lot of people talk about supporters and opposers, or you know, pro or anti or whatever. But you only have to look at politics to understand that, you know, politicians don't care too much about their supporters, and they don't care about the supporters of the other parties. What they care about are the floating voters, because they're the ones whose minds they can change. You can be reasonably abusive to your supporters, because they will vote for you because they don't want to vote for the others. And there's nothing you can do to get a dyed-in-the-wool person on one side of the political argument to vote for you if you're on the other side. Right. But it's the floating voters. So I love that. The other thing I like is, you know, the suggestion that maybe you don't share what, you know, C, F and S stand for, because I've spent a lot of time in the UK working with public sector, training them in project management. And here in the UK, our public sector, and I'm sure there are lots of other places where this is true too, we have a freedom of information law, which means that anyone can summon up anything that's been written down by the public servants. Mm-hmm. So if you write something that you may regret being on the side of a bus, don't put anything in your project notes that you wouldn't be prepared to see on the evening news. Right. So I think that's a great tip. But what I want to come back to is part of the challenge is, how do we keep track of them and what we have said to them? Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. we have a lot of conversations with stakeholders, everything from, you know, a general email out to multiple stakeholders who may not be our core, you know, high priority stakeholders, but there's a lot of them, and those emails go out, which are easy to track. But then, you know, you and your senior team will be out there day to day talking with senior stakeholders, having conversations, forming your ideas about priorities and things. So how do you track all of that?
Yeah, it's that's a challenge, right? But on the, like in our SAM, on the right-hand side is the communication yep. plan.
Yeah.
And so organize, you know, so a major way that you will manage your stakeholders is through communication. So yeah. having a thoughtful plan for and a cadence for when you're going to touch those stakeholders, what some of those communications are, having it organized, having it accessible to, you know, the key people on your team, right? And having, you know, using the technology, you know, of folders and communicate, you know, all that stuff, yeah. having it there. And in a big project like this person's talking about, and what we had with our $100 yeah. million bet was, we had our own internal website.
Yeah.
That, you know, we started to formulate the FAQs page. We started to, you know, have the like official answers
yeah.
out there, right? And so when you, you know, there's a lot of communication that you don't need to track. Like, don't make yourself crazy, but yeah. you have to have someone who is really great at communication when you're in a situation like that. So we had a woman who was my lead on the project for change communication and training. Yeah. So she led a whole area around that. It was her job to run the communication plan. It was her job to send the emails. It was her, right? So because yeah. she is brilliant at this.
Yeah.
So she yeah. organized all of that. Again, it doesn't always have to be you as the project manager.
And in a big project, it shouldn't be. You've got right. other things to do.
Yeah. 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 So I love the communication plan idea. I love the project website, you know, to help make sure that the official communications are very clear, you know, for your stakeholders, whether they're, you know,
yeah,
wherever yeah. they are on the spectrum.
The last big project I worked on when I was a consultant was a big was the congestion charge in London. And that has huge political kind of focus on it. Very, very big project. And in fact, we actually engaged, or the client engaged, a communications agency because it was highly political, and they tracked all the communications. And one thing I learned from them is the importance of when your project communications get big, and it's going to be true, I guess, when other aspects of your project get big, is to look outside of the project world for tools and resources. And I've learned over the last few years a lot about marketing because, like you, run my own business and need to market it. And the thing that struck me when I was starting to write about advanced stakeholder engagement is how useful on a big project CRM systems can be. CRM systems, customer relationship management, are systems that are designed to manage and track interactions with customers. So if we exchange the word customer for stakeholder, you've got an army of tools. And of course, a lot of organizations already have CRM systems embedded in the organization. And therefore, you can create a fresh list and use that. And the whole, you know, marketers have this idea of personas or avatars where they describe a particular type of customer or a particular type of prospect. We can do that. We can create avatars for, you know, particular types of stakeholder on our projects. We can use those to guide our planning, which is what you've talked about. But I think the idea of bringing in a CRM system has got to be, for this questioner, if they think the load is getting so big that they want a tool, because project management tools aren't designed for that, but CRM tools are. And of course, I know, use Office 365, or Microsoft 365, and that has its own CRM tools as well. So if you're in an organization that has tools like that, you can kind of integrate it with some of your project tools.
I love that. That's a brilliant solution for when it gets really big and scary and hairy.
Yeah, absolutely. Any other thoughts somewhere on the spectrum from small and simple? Because your chart, that SAM chart, has the real benefit. It scales, doesn't it? You can envisage it having several thousand rows if you need it.
Yeah.
It becomes hard to manage, but it can work. But it can also work for the small project that any manager or any professional just has to do as part of their job. Any other thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, I think some people don't cast a wide enough net on their stakeholders. So you had said earlier, like, you know, some people think they only have a few stakeholders, but really they need to think more broadly about it. Yeah. So that's I found that to be the case for people. They really need to think much more broadly about who might love their project, hate their project, or be somewhere in between.
Yeah.
And so, like, even, you know, if you're installing a swimming pool at your home, right?
Yep.
Your neighbors are stakeholders.
Absolutely.
Right.
Yeah.
And you may have, you know, neighbors who are friends who are going to be fine, you know, and they're the other neighbors.
Yeah.
Right. And so you're probably going to do more work to keep those other neighbors.
Oh, it's always the potential saboteurs that are your first priority.
Yeah.
Because they will work harder against you than your cheerleaders will work in support of you.
Yeah, exactly. And so I find that some people are scared to name who the saboteurs are. And you can't be. You really have to have the courage to think about it and to get people to think about it and then think about, what are we going to do about this?
Yeah. And I like the swim pool example. Not that we have them here in the UK because it's too cold, but in Florida, I guess lots of your neighbors. But the swimming pool, you know, you might think, well, you know, what business is it of theirs if I've got a swimming pool? And the answer is, if you use it in a sensible manner, they won't notice you've got a swimming pool. But they will notice when you've got diggers in your garden making a lot of noise and you've got workmen parking on the street. So that kind of reminds us that when we're thinking about who our stakeholders are, one way to segment them is the stakeholders who will have a particular interest during the execution of the project. Mm-hmm. And then there are the stakeholders who are primarily affected by the outcome of the project. And of course, some stakeholders fit nicely into both categories, but that's a really good way of thinking about them. I like that.
Yeah, and that's a great point too, is to, you know, as part of casting the wide net, is to ask your team, okay, who cares about the project part and who cares about the other part? And, you know, and then where are those overlaps, right?
Yeah.
Because that it's your stakeholders might be a little more intense if they're in both camps.
Yeah. And asking your team, for me, that's always the number one piece of advice about identifying stakeholders. It's a great team building activity at the start of your project. Just sit around and think, who might in some way feel themselves affected by this? And you just don't reject any of them. You might put them to the bottom of the priority list. But if someone thinks they're affected by it, then they think they're affected by it. So you've got to deal with that. And so that's the team has got that kind of breadth of wisdom, but it's a great way to see how people think and to get everyone contributing. I like that.
Yeah, absolutely. And then kick them all out when you're working on the cheerleader, finicky fan, or saboteur, except for your trusted circle, you know, your little circle of trust, right?
Yeah.
Like, because you don't want it on the side of the bus or whatever.
So different people have a different approach to this. What's your approach when you say, well, we kind of know that stakeholders are out there, but we have no idea how they're going to think. They might be a cheerleader, but they might be a saboteur. They might not have made up their mind. They may be that fit. What do you do with those unknown stakeholders?
Well, you know, sometimes it doesn't matter. And you'll be like, you know what? We're going to decide that if this impacts us, then we'll deal with it. Just like a risk, you know, when you're like, you can decide that you're just going to accept the risk. Right. That maybe we don't know all the things that we, or, you know, and that's really up to your sponsor to decide, right? Are we going to accept this risk that we don't know a lot about these people? Or are you going to make that part of your job in the project to figure it out?
Yeah.
Right. Is it going to be part of the tasks on the project to figure it out? Yeah. Like create the avatars, engage, you know, try to reach out to some people, get some interviews with them, ask their opinions, you know, whatever the content of the project is kind of matters for how you might do some of these things. But you get to, I think you need, the best part is to be conscious about it and make a conscious choice.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's the rule with all decision-making, isn't it? It's the process of how you make the decision that matters. You will get it wrong sometimes. That's life. I say, you know, exactly the same. You either have a kind of car park for the unknowns and you then figure out how to do it. The trick, of course, is if they are, in your term, saboteurs, going out and asking them what they think is like kicking a hornet's nest. You just didn't know there were hornets at home when you kicked it. So you've got to think through. You've got to think through the potential contingency plans. And the other option is just to treat them as potential saboteurs, and maybe you'll be delighted if they're not.
Right. Yeah, that could be true too, for sure. Yeah, and I mean, there's the, I don't know about you, but I like mob movies. I mean, I am American, but I like my mob movies, and they have, you know, there's a phrase like that you know, keep your friends close and your enemies closer.
Yeah.
Right. And I feel like that's my sort of line for the saboteur bit is I would rather keep my enemies closer and know, you know, and try to stay on top of where are they? What are they thinking? What are they doing? Are they coming up back behind me? You know, I want to know. Yeah.
Well, there's that slightly crude kind of metaphor of bringing people into the tent because the psychology behind that, of course, if people feel they have no control, they will struggle to create control. And that becomes the meddling and the disruptive behavior. If you can bring even your saboteurs into the project, if you find a way where you can give them a say on some part of the project, then that dispels some of their need for control, doesn't it? And then because they have a say in one thing and they feel they've got a little bit of control, they don't feel the need so much to sabotage other parts of the project. So that's a good strategy.
And that's a great reminder of, you know, I mean, if you understand the motivation behind the reason that they are a saboteur for your project, and you can figure out a way to actually turn them into a cheerleader, that is like the best thing ever. Because anybody that knows that they were a saboteur and they see that this person has transformed their whole outlook on the thing, that speaks volumes for the project, right?
Yeah. And there's no one quite so evangelical as a convert. That's
exactly. So that's an opportunity.
Yeah.
You know, is to the more your saboteurs can actually really help you make your project better if you do it right.
Yeah, absolutely. And my golden rule for dealing with resistance is always respect the resistors. You know, you may not respect their point of view, or certainly won't agree with it. And you're entitled to not respect the way they express themselves if they are being disrespectful or worse. But the people who are resisting, the people who are trying to sabotage your project, are doing it for what they consider to be the right reasons, even if you can't see how they're the right reasons. And if you treat them with respect, you have a better chance of understanding their reasoning, and therefore a better chance of getting the insights you need to either persuade them and bring them around, or possibly recognize that they've got a point somewhere deep in their argument. They know something you don't know. And if you make a change to your project, not only do you bring them on board, but you get a better project as well.
Yeah. Amen.
I think that's a great place to summarize. So I think I think that the top tips specifically for the managing quantity thing is, firstly, segment them. And you've given us a great way to segment them into our cheerleaders, into our,
finicky fans.
Finicky fans, that's it, and our saboteurs.
And by the way, a little tip on that is one of my coaching clients was like, what's the F stand for? On the fence. So it's the same. That's excellent also. Yeah, so that's
another. So first one is to segment. Second, use a simple tool, like a big old spreadsheet, which you can then extend with other fields to track the communications you intend to make, and also the communications you've had. If you get to the very big scale, then as your project grows, think about appointing someone as a specialist communication lead. And maybe, you know, as it gets bigger, a communications team. And then is there software that you can access for managing the customer relationships and tracking them? Do we have any other specific ones about the scale?
Yeah, no, I love your point about, you know, why not use a CRM tool if it's really, you know, big and hairy and scary. Yeah. I think it's brilliant. Yeah. Cause sometimes, you know, if your spreadsheet starts to get too unwieldy, it's not helpful anymore.
Yeah.
And those tools are absolutely built for this. So that was a brilliant idea. Yeah.
Right. Well, I think we've not only got some really good answers, and we've got the kind of three that I hoped to get. I hope we could get to three answers, or three components of an answer, three strategies. But we've got lots of other tips for anyone who's listening as well. So Dawn, thank you very much for joining me on this, and for contributing your experience on managing and engaging with stakeholders.
My pleasure is always, Mike. Call me anytime you want to chat. It's always fun. And I love hearing your accent, of course.
Well, I'll see you tomorrow. Thank you very much, and see you next time.
Bye.